Thank you, Michel Pierre.
It's really fantastic to be here. I am mainly familiar with rich systems, biodiverse systems, woody systems in southwestern Australia, but I just spent a month in Brazil where the system looks a little bit more like this. It's a bit of a combination of your grasslands and of our woody systems in southwestern Australia. But what all these three systems really have in common is that you have the greatest biodiversity where the soils are poorest. And in the systems that I just referred to in southwestern Australia and in Brazil, the main nutrient that is the limiting factor is phosphorus. And I would not be surprised at all if that were exactly the same here in your biodiverse grassland system. But I think further research is actually necessary to actually further explore that. I think that is really a fantastic question. I think soil factors are really the key drivers for a lot of the biodiversity that we can see in the world. You can go to tropical systems, you can go to the Quongan that I work on in southwestern Australia, you can go to the Campos Rupestres that I just visited in Brazil, for example, and what they all have in common is that we find the greatest diversity on the soils that are the poorest. So, indeed, soil factors are major drivers for biodiversity. When you go to tropical rainforests, the diversity there is also on nutrient-poor soils, but the diversity is largely by going up. I mean, we've got an enormous variation in light intensity, in light climate, and plants really have acclimated and adapted to that. When you go to nutrient-poor grasslands, when you go to nutrient-poor woody systems like in southwestern Australia, it's not what happens above ground. I mean, of course, that is important. These plants have to photosynthesize, they've got to capture light. But what's really important is what they are doing below ground. That is where the action is. That is where they are competing. Maybe they are helping each other from time to time. And they're all doing, if you look at this system over here, they're all doing different things. We've got the orchids over there, they've got their mycorrhizas with a specialized type of mycorrhiza. We've got some parasites there, the Rhinanthus. They get their nutrients from their neighbors, they basically steal them. Then we've got some sedges in the system. They're not mycorrhizal, and we do know that they make specialized roots and they basically mine the phosphate from the soil. So in this system, above ground, it all looks pretty similar. But below ground, there's a lot of action going on of which we have no clue at all. And I think that really deserves a lot more attention from scientists, from botanists, to actually explore what's going on over here. And we are now developing the techniques to be able to actually do that. So now is the time to really get cracking and do some wonderful projects. There is heaps of opportunities for student projects in this exact area. And if we can do that in collaboration with what we are doing in southwestern Australia, or in combination with what's actually going on in Brazil, or also in species-rich, nutrient-poor grasslands in Uruguay, I think if we do that in collaboration, we can make tremendous progress, streets ahead of what's going on in the rest of the world. And I'd really like to be part of that. That is again a very good question, and if you look at this soil here, for example, this is calcareous soil, and basically that means that it is very hard for plants to get nutrients such as phosphorus, iron, manganese and copper, nutrients that all plants, and we too, nutrients that all plants actually need. So how do you actually get the nutrients out of this soil when they are very poorly available? Well, you can either decide to pack your bags and go somewhere else, but plants are not very good at walking away. So they basically will have to do things with the local soil. And so what they do is they basically modify the soil. They make it locally more acidic. They release compounds like citrate and malate, for example. And that is exactly how they modify the soil and make the poorly available nutrients in this soil much better available. So they are really engineering the soil. They make it more appropriate. And if you can't do that, you're not going to grow in this calcareous soil. And you really have to find yourself a neutral soil or an acidic soil. That's where you can make it, but you won't be able to make it. You will be outcompeted. You will become deficient in less than no time. These plants don't show any deficiency symptoms at all because they are really adapted. They modify, they locally modify the rhizosphere, the environment immediately surrounding the roots. That's what these guys are doing. I think we have tremendous potential. We just looked at a biodiverse grasslands, and there may be competition going on one hand, but I think there's also something that we call facilitation going on. And with that we mean that one plant actually does something that can actually help another plant. Now here, in this system over here, we see that we have a wheat crop, yes. But that wheat crop is not just one cultivar. There's a short-strawed one like this. There's a modern variety where we have reduced the size of the stem to get more of the resources in the ear and in the grain rather than in the stem. But there's also an older variety that is a tall stem, and they may be doing different things. But what's more important in this system over here, that we don't just have the wheat, we also have a number of legumes. There's a pea over here, for example. And I think that pea can be very important in this system, because this is a cereal. That cereal needs nitrogen, but it needs nitrogen to be taken up from the soil. Well, this is a legume. The legume can take nitrogen up from the soil, yes, but it can also fix atmospheric nitrogen itself in symbiosis with rhizobial bacteria that live in the nodules that are produced in the root system over here. And you can really see that this legume could actually provide some nitrogen for this cereal. And in experiments that I've been involved in with a group in China, at China Agricultural University, we really demonstrated if we have something like a grass, or a cereal if you like, and something like a pea or another legume, then this legume actually starts working a little bit faster, for the simple reason that this one is actually stealing all the nitrogen as quickly as it can. And so this one will actually have to work a little bit faster to actually get enough nitrogen. So having the intercropping system basically means that you don't need to feed the cereal as much nitrogen, and this legume actually works a little bit faster to actually fix all that nitrogen. Now that's just one example. I mean, a lot of these legumes, they're also very good at getting phosphorus out of the soil, and they do that by releasing something like citrate or malate. And we know that field pea does exactly that. So not only does it provide nitrogen, which the neighbor can actually benefit from, but it also mobilizes phosphorus in these calcareous soils where phosphorus is very hard to get, it is very poorly available, it can actually mobilize that phosphorus. Well, it may do that for its own benefit, and it can benefit from it itself, but the neighbor can also benefit from it. And in experiments done in pots in Western Australia, for example, we've clearly demonstrated that one can really help the neighbor's plants. So having a mixture enhances the biodiversity, and there are lots of advantages also in terms of pests and plagues and insect damage, for example. But in terms of mineral nutrition, and that's my personal area, that's where I work on, that's where the intercropping is also an enormous benefit. The only problem then comes when the farmer starts harvesting the material. But clearly, these days farmers have good machines, and they don't have to do it like they do in China, where you have a few rows of this and a few rows of that. Here, as you see, it's all mixed. And as long as we can harvest all those seeds at the same time, those seeds can be separated by machines later on. That doesn't need to be done by hand at all. So if that is used as an argument against intercropping, it's not a particularly good argument, because the Danes have actually solved that problem, and they can actually harvest everything together and separate the seeds afterwards without any problems at all. So I think looking at what the natural system actually does and trying to work out what sort of positive interactions are actually going on, it's not just about competition, there's a lot of positive interactions going on as well, learning from that, and then putting combinations together of species where we know this one does that and the other one does that. Well, putting the right combinations together can really increase the yields and the yield stability enormously. And the Chinese have shown tremendous outcomes there, where the yields can go up by 20-30%. Well, every farmer would be very keen with would be very happy with an increase of about 5%. If they can get an increase of about 20-30% like they do in China, well, I think every farmer would be very, very happy. And it is actually more ecological as well.